This is Chapter 11, Polyphase Circuits, Sections 3 through 5. The learning goals for these sections are source load connections, the so-called delta Y, the power relationships. We've studied power before in single phase circuits. This is now for polyphase circuits, and in particular three phase circuits. And then power factor correction. We've also studied that before, but now we're going to look at power factor improvements now in three-phase circuits, the common industrial electrical supply. Section 3, source load connections. Here we have the so-called balanced YY connection. As we saw in the previous sections, sometimes you can't identify this as a YY, but this would be the characteristic form of it. Usually we can tell because the load impedances, Z sub Y, are all connected together on one side and provide the neutral return, or I sub N current flowing in the neutral return. VAN will take as magnitude of VP, angle 0. VBN is magnitude VP, angle minus 120. And V sub CN is magnitude VP, angle plus 120. Positive sequences then of phase voltages. The line voltages that exist, we can plot, for example, VAN, VBN, and VCN as phasors, can be taken together and produce, for example, as shown in this graphic, VAB, which is the interaction of A and B, if you will. VAB is equal to VAN minus VBN. And notice the minus VBN, which we didn't think on first impression, but it is a negative since it's the differences. So magnitude VP angle 0 minus magnitude VP angle minus 120 becomes, by trigonometric manipulation, magnitude VP quantity 1 minus cosine 120 minus J sine 120. We've recast it in rectangular form. And then magnitude VP minus magnitude VP times quantity 1 half minus J cube root of 3 over 2. That can be rendered from a rectangular form, which this is, to a polar form. And again, you should perform the calculation. And the answer becomes the square root of 3, magnitude of VP, angle 30 degrees. And that sort of agrees with the graphic that we see in the upper right-hand corner. It certainly seems to be about 30 degrees. And the amplitude is certainly larger than unity, and the square root of 3 is larger than unity. VBC can be calculated by a similar calculation. You might want to try one of these just to see if you get the same results. VBC is the square root of 3, the magnitude of VP, angle minus 90. And VCA is the square root of 3, magnitude VP, angle minus 210. And we can plot those resultant phasors, if you will, on this particular graph. Notice that the compound voltages, VAB, VBC, VCA, are actually larger magnitudes. We can see that just from the vectors, from the phasors, than the original phase voltages. V sub L is equal to the square root of 3 times the magnitude of VP. We'll call that the line voltage as a result. And that's the common magnitudes of these particular compound voltages that we have on our distribution system. IA is VAN divided by ZY, IB is VBN divided by ZY, and IC is equal to VCN divided by ZY. Here we're assuming that all the impedances in the balanced YY connection are in fact equal. IA then is the magnitude of IL angle 0, angle theta degrees. IB is the magnitude of IL angle theta minus 120 degrees, and IC is the magnitude of IL angle theta plus 120. The angle theta exists because of the relationship of the compound complex impedance, ZY, and that produces a phase angle theta. If the ZYs are in fact just purely resistive, then the theta is actually 0 degrees. We can add up the terms in current, and we do know in a balanced YY connection that IA plus IB plus IC equals IN, the neutral current, and that has to be identically zero for balance. So we can write down for balanced circuit that I sub n is equal to 0. And for this balanced circuit, it is enough to just basically analyze one phase, since the other phases are in fact identical with the same load impedances. For an ABC sequence, balanced YY three-phase circuit, let's take VAB equals 208 angle minus 30 degrees volts RMS. Determine the phase voltages. Here's our schematic for that particular representation in the balanced YY configuration. Here is our phasor relationship of the three voltages on these three polyphase circuits in the positive sequence ABC, where A leads B leads C, essentially. The phasor diagram could be rotated, in fact, by any angle that you want, but that would be one way of representing it. VAN is equal to the magnitude of VP, angle 0. VBN is equal to the magnitude of VP, angle minus 120. And VCN is magnitude VP, angle 120 as a result. And here, of course, are these diagrams that we just related for the three different phases. And that's the relationship between phase and line voltages as a result. VAB is the square root of 3, magnitude of VP, angle 30. VAN lags VAB by 30 degrees. VAB is 208 angle minus 30. And therefore, VAN is the magnitude of VAB divided by the square root of 3, whose angle is minus 30 minus 30, or overall minus 60. So VAN is 120. Angle minus 60 degrees. VBN is 120 angle minus 180. And VAN, that should be VCN. VCN is 120 angle 60 degrees. In this learning example, we'll have an ABC sequence again, a balanced YY three-phase circuit. We'll have the source magnitude of the phase voltage to be 120 volts RMS. We'll have the impedance of the transmission line, which we haven't seen before, but we'll take that to be 1 plus J 1 ohms. And the impedance on each phase we'll take to be equal, and it'll be 20 plus J 10 ohms in this case. And we are to determine the line currents and load voltages. Because the circuit is balanced, the data on any one phase is sufficient to calculate all the other phases. So we can draw a circuit diagram of a single phase. For example, VAN has a current I sub little a capital A going through a 1 ohm resistor and a J 1 ohm inductive reactance at the port A to a load, which is 20 ohms in series with J 10, with the neutral return capital N to little n then. And of course, V capital A capital N is the voltage that we're interested in. And that seems to be a voltage divider. We can choose VAN as 120 angle 0, and we'll choose that to be a reference. Note it's the small letters A and N. And therefore, we do know what the different phases are, and we can relate that as our final answer in an ABC type sequence. I sub little a capital A is going to be VAN divided by the total impedance, and the total impedance is 1 ohm plus 20 ohms, or 21 ohms, plus J1 plus J10, or plus J11, if you will. Recasting that in polar form, 120 angle 0 divided by 23.71 angle 27.65 degrees gives us I sub little a capital A as 5.06 angle minus 27.65 degrees amperes RMS. Similarly, since we've already calculated I sub AA, then I sub BB only is a phase difference, and the phase difference is a minus 120 degrees initially. So it's 5.06 angle minus 120 minus 27.65, if you will, overall. And I sub CC would be the same magnitude, 5.06 angle 120 plus 120 in this case, minus 27.65 degrees amperes RMS. So in a balanced situation, we only need to solve it for one phase. V sub a n then is I sub a times 20 plus j10. It would be I sub a times the equivalent of 20 plus j10 in polar form, 22.36, angle 26.57 degrees. Making a substitution and solving, we get VAN is 113.15, angle minus 1.08 degrees, volts, RMS. And of course, we can calculate just by inspection what the other voltages are since it's a balanced system. VBN would come from B, little b, little n, and it's an additional minus 120 degrees, so same magnitude, 113.15, angle minus 121.08, and VCN would be the same, except the angle is plus 120, minus 1.08, gives us 113.15 for magnitude, angle 118.92 degrees, volts, RMS for the voltage. Let's take another ABC sequence, balanced YY three-phase circuit. We'll take VAN to be 120, angle 90 degrees in this case. And all we have is a shifted version of the reference phase voltage. Used to be zero, now it's 90 degrees. Find the line voltages. Well, the shift in phase basically can be handled in the solution. We do know what the basic relationships are. As shown here, if VAN is at 0 degrees, it's the horizontal phasor in gray, called V sub AN, if you will. And therefore, we know that VAB is, as we found, the square root of 3, magnitude of VP, angle 30, and VAN lags VAB by 30 degrees. Those were our former solutions. So in this case, we do know that VAB leads VAN by 30 degrees. Therefore, VAB, little ab, VA little b, is equal to the square root of 3 times 120 at an angle of 120 degrees. VBC, same magnitude, angle 0 degrees. And VCA, same magnitude, angle 240. So what we've done essentially is we've just rotated it by an additional 30 degrees. So VAN came in at 120 angle 90, and VAB then comes out as the magnitude has changed, of course, square root of 3 times 120, but the angle is 90 plus 30 is 120. And basically, we've rotated those phases to agree at that point. VAB then is 208 angle 0. Find the phase voltages. This is another problem. VAN lags VAB by 30 degrees here. Therefore, VAN is equal to 208, the square root of 3, divided by the square root of 3, angle minus 30, that's what lag means, degrees, volts RMS. VBN would then be lagging again, same magnitude, but an angle of minus 150. And VCN would be the same magnitude, but now at an angle of 90 degrees. So we can rotate the phasors by any amount using something as a reference, like VAN, for example. And everything else rotates by the same amount, whether it's leading or lagging. We've already seen if it leads, we add. If it lags, we subtract. Another learning extension, ABC sequence, balanced YY three-phase circuit. The load has a V on each phase, V phase of 104.02 volts RMS at an angle of 26.6 degrees. The impedance of the line is 1 plus J1 again, and the impedance of each load impedance, Z phase he calls it, is equal to 8 plus J3 in this case. Determine the source phase voltage. So here we're working it backwards, essentially. So here we know that VAN is the given 104.02, angle 26.6 degrees, volts RMS. That was not written that way. It wasn't written as VAN, but that's what we mean by the phase at the load, if you will. load phase, if you will. That's what he called it. Currents are not required in this case. We're just going to use an inverse voltage divider. We don't have to find it. We could find the current, but if we know the voltage at one point, we can, and the impedances, we can do a reverse in voltage divider and find V sub little an directly from this circuit. So V sub little an would be the reverse voltage divider, which in this case is the sum of the impedances, in this case 8 plus J3 plus quantity 1 plus J1, divided by, in this case, the opposite impedance, because we've already known what that input voltage is, VAN, so we're going to use 8 plus J3 downstairs, if you will. And that's essentially the reverse voltage divider as a result, algebraically. Making a substitution and normalization, we can determine what the first term is. It turns out the first term is 1.15 angle 3.41 degrees. We've normalized it, of course, so we can do the division correctly. Since the numerator is a wholly real number, we don't have to deal with phasor forms. We can just divide directly. And he's already made the correct conversion from rectangular form, which would be 84 over 73 real, plus J5 over 73 complex, to produce a magnitude of 1.15 angle 3.41. Again, you might want to try that on your calculator. Therefore, VAN, which is what we're looking for, is the product of the two voltage, the impedance that we just found, and also the impedance divider that we just found, and also V sub capital AN, which is given. And again, the answer turns out to be 120 angle 30 degrees. In this case, RMS, because everything starts out at RMS, therefore it's RMS. So that's the positive sequence ABC representation, and we end up in this case with a rotated phasor for VAN by an angle of 30 degrees. But we said all rotations are possible, and therefore the other phasors rotate by the same amount. Therefore, VBN, same magnitude, 120, but angle minus 90, and VCN, same magnitude, but angle 150 degrees. Again, you should consider these as important things to note that you can solve in one phase, and if you know what that phase relationship is, you can apply that directly to the other phases. In the next section, let's consider delta-connected sources. And we noticed in the initial sections of this chapter that a delta-connected source does not have a neutral or a neutral current return. So here's our delta circuit connections, if you will, from our three sources, providing three currents, IA, IB, and IC, to an arbitrary network. We'll take VAB then to be the square root of 3 times the magnitude of VP at an angle of 30 degrees. And we'll say that VAN lags VAB by 30 degrees as a result. And we can plot these things, even though there is no essentially a virtual neutral, but we still can consider those voltages with respect to ground or some other reference, if you will. And we still get the same sort of relationship here. And VAN lags VAB by 30 degrees. Now, you can do what is called a delta to Y conversion. Sometimes that's useful. We can convert the delta implementation, notice between little a, little b, and little c. That's the only thing we touch. We can convert that then to VAN, VBN, and VCN. And that is a virtual neutral connection, but it helps us sometimes to do calculations as a result. And the relationships there are that VAB, which is what we started out with, is V sub L angle 0 degrees, VBC is V sub L angle minus 120, and VCA is V sub L angle 120. The other one was minus 120, of course. That can be converted to VAN, and the answer is V sub L divided by the square root of 3 angle minus 30. And we look at that literally from the graphic that we see on the left side. VBN is V sub L divided by the square root of 3 angle minus 150, and V sub N Cn, V sub Cn, is V sub L divided by the square root of 3 angle 90. Again, we're looking at the graphic and we're using that as our reference at the moment. So in this case, we know that Van lags Vab by 30 degrees. So we can now calculate, starting off with that particular lag situation. If you look at the graphic, Vab is initially at 30 degrees, but is now lagging by an additional 30. So Vab is actually 208 angle 60 degrees. 30 plus 30 is 60. And Vbc is now, used to be minus 90 degrees. If you look at the graphic, the phasor pointing straight down is at minus 90 for Vbc. So we have a magnitude of 208, again, lagging by 30 degrees. Instead of minus 90, we now get minus 60. And likewise, an additional 30 degrees for VCA gives us 208 angle 180. And again, the graphic helps a lot to figure the phasor rotations. And under those conditions, we can apply those answers directly. So VAN becomes 120 angle 30 as a result. VBN becomes 120 angle minus 90 as a result. And VCN becomes 120 angle 150. Again, we look at the reference voltages. For example, we started out by saying VAB was VL angle 0 degrees. And then we determined with the new predicate that VAN lags VAB by 30. We find out that that becomes VAB is equal to 208 angle 60 degrees. And that produces a VAN angle 120 as a result, angle 30 as a result. 120 volts RMS at an angle of 30 degrees. So we basically kept rotating the phasors. This may be somewhat confusing, so I think you should study the phasor rotation concept, starting with one reference point and then working your way around using this particular graphic as a starting point. All right, well, sometimes doing a problem helps a lot also. Here we want to determine the line currents and line voltages at the load. And what we'd have to do, first of all, is identify what we're looking at here. That seems to be a delta connection. I don't see a neutral return. And it seems to be equal impedances, equal transmission line impedances, and equal impedances for loads. The loads themselves start at capital A, capital B, capital C. Source is then delta connected, and we're going to convert it to the equivalent Y just to make the calculation easier and much more straightforward. We've already figured out how to do that. And again, these should be in your notes. This is for a standard representation. VAB is equal to V sub L angle 0 degrees. VBC is V sub L angle minus 120. And VCA is V sub L angle plus 120. When I convert it to the delta, I get VAN as VL divided by the square root of 3, but the angle becomes minus 30 degrees. VBN is V sub L divided by the square root of 3, angle minus 150. And VCN is V sub L square root of 3, again, angle 90 degrees. Essentially, we've added a minus 30 degrees to the original as we rotated the phasor around for the delta to equivalent Y connection. We can analyze just one phase because these happen to be equal impedances and equal line impedances, and set up an equation and a schematic that can do that. We've now converted, of course, from the original delta correction to a Y circuit. We have 208 divided by the square root of 3 is our amplitude. That's V sub L divided by the square root of 3 at an angle of minus 30 degrees. We're, of course, looking at the A circuit, the VAN, as a result. And we have our line and source impedances listed. And we can calculate the current. You can also do a voltage divider. You might want to try both schemes and you should get the same answer. But I sub little a capital A can be calculated. We have 208 divided by the square root of 3 at an angle of minus 30 degrees. And we divide by the overall impedance, which is 0.1 plus 12, or 12.1, real, plus J.2 plus J.4, which gives us J4.2, imaginary or complex, provide our calculation. We have to reduce the downstairs to polar form and then do a division. If you, again, try it with your calculator, you get 9.38 angle minus 49.14 degrees amperes RMS for the, in this case, the delta connected circuit in the A circuit, if you will, with equal impedances throughout. So V sub A n then can now be calculated because we know the current and we know the impedance of the load. It's 12 plus J4. We have to reduce that to polar form and then multiply by the current in polar form. And the answer becomes 118.65 angle minus 30.71 volts RMS for V sub capital A n. V sub little AB is the square root of 3 times the magnitude of VP at an angle of 30 degrees in this case. And V sub capital AB is the square root of 3 times the voltage we just calculated. Notice the difference between little AB and capital AB. And that it becomes the square root of 3 times 1.1865 times angle of 0.71 degrees, if you will. And we can use the other phases using the balanced idea and the fact that all we have to do is do phase rotations. And here, in fact, are the currents. Again, you should validate that in your own mind. It's a good test of your understanding of three-phase circuits. And here are the resulting voltages. Again, you should validate that by doing the pencil paper calcs in your own way so that you can have it in your notes and also understand the phase rotations. Okay, here we have another learning example. Compute the magnitude of the line voltage at the load. So we have, again, a delta-connected input circuit. I can recognize that. I have our line impedances and our load impedances. And we do have a point labeled capital N, but we're not really seeing a line return because that's a delta connection, but that we'll still call that the neutral at the load side. The source is delta connected. We'll convert it to the equivalent Y. And again, I'm not going to read those equations because that is our formulation that you should have in your notes. This, of course, is for a reference in which V little AB is VL angle 0. And if we rotate V little AB, then everything would rotate by the same amount. We're going to analyze one phase. We can certainly do that. We've done this a few times. Looks very similar in this case. We can get V sub capital AN. We're only interested in the magnitude. Well, all right, that's what the problem asks for, fine. We can then calculate the magnitude of VAN from the given complex expression. The magnitude of VAN is 120. Again, you should try this with your calculator. And we've reduced those complex numbers to 10.77 in the numerator and 10.90 in the denominator. We don't care about the phase angle. And as a result, we can do the straight real calculation and end up with the magnitude of 118.57. Often in electrical engineering power practice, we are interested in magnitudes at this particular time. V sub little AB then is the square root of 3 times the magnitude of VP at an angle of 30 degrees. And V sub capital AB then is 205.2 volts RMS. Again, looking at these things very carefully, it's important to understand the relationships between the input voltages and the load voltages. In this case, the difference between subscripts with little letters and subscripts with large capital letters. Here we have another example of a delta connected load. I can see that because there's no configuration which has a neutral return. So the first method is to solve it directly. Here are our standard equations for the delta connected mode. And we have our solutions for VAN, VB, and N, and VCN, which is our sources. And then our delta connected derived voltages, VAB, VBC, and VCA, as illustrated in the figure. And we have positive sequence, ABC, for the phase voltages. We know what the load phase currents are because we've looked at problems like this. We have IAB is VAB over Z delta, which is I delta at an angle theta delta. IBC, similarly, is I delta angle theta delta, but minus 120 degrees because of the phase. And ICA is I delta angle theta delta at plus 120 degrees. Now, Z delta is the magnitude of Z at some angle theta Z. And theta delta is 30 degrees minus theta Z, because that's what the transformation would be. The line currents then can be written as, for example, capital A would be IAB minus ICA, as illustrated in the figure. And IBB is IBC minus IAB. And ICC would be ICA minus IBC. There's a second method, though. We can also convert the delta-connected load to a Y-connected load. The same formulas derived for resistive circuits are then applicable to the impedances because they're equal across all the loads. And in the balance case, ZY would be Z delta divided by 3 as a result. And that's important to remember if we want to make the conversion. And then I sub AA would be VAN divided by ZY, and of course ZY is Z delta divided by 3, which would be the magnitude of IAA at an angle theta L, and L being the load. And we can rectify that in other terms. So for example, IAA magnitude would be the magnitude of VAB divided by the cube root of 3, divided by the magnitude of Z delta divided by 3. That's just a direct substitution for ZY. And then theta L is equal to minus theta Z as a result. I line would be the square root of 3 times the magnitude of I delta. And theta on the line would be theta delta minus 30 degrees. That would be the line phase current relationships. So let's do a review of delta to Y transformations. And to make it a little bit easier, we could do this with resistors at the moment because they're linear components and real. So here we have an examples of delta to Y transformations shown at the top of the page. And we can calculate all of the different resistances that we're looking at here, for example, in the transformations back and forth. So the equations are written for us so that we can use standard calculations of resistance values in series and parallel, which is what we're doing there, to make the transformations back and forth. So the processing would be subtract the first two equations, then add it to the third to get R sub A. And we could replace that in the third equation and then finally solve for R1, for example. So we can go back and forth between the two different configurations as a result. These equations would be reasonable to have in your notes, so, and also the figure, so you can understand what the transformation would be going back and forth. And here we have the answers as a result, solving for RA, R sub little a, I should say, and R sub little b and R sub little c, which is going from the delta to the Y transformation, given R1, R2, and R3 in the original delta. And then going backwards, we can do R1, R2, and R3, shown on the lower right, in terms of RA, RB, and RC, that is starting from the Y and going back to the delta. R delta is equal to R1 is equal to R2 equals R3, and RY would be R delta divided by 3, if they were equally balanced loads, for example. Here we have the line phase current relationships. We've been talking about the vector representation in the upper right hand corner. Magnitude of V delta equals the square root of 3 times magnitude of V phase. Theta delta equals theta phase plus 30 degrees. That's our line phase relationship. Sometimes the equations are not as telling as the graphics. The graphics really tell us everything. Likewise, in the center of the display, we have magnitude of I line equals the cube root of 3 times the magnitude of I delta. And theta line is equal to theta delta minus 30 degrees. That's the line phase current relationships. Upper right, line phase voltage relationship. Center of the slide, line phase current relationships going between delta and y configurations, delta on the bottom and y on the top. So for our learning extension, let's try I sub A, capital A equals 12 angle 40. And of course, we now know that that's going to be an offset phase angle because it's no longer zero. Find the phase currents. You should try this as a problem, a learning extension. By definition, we get IAB is equal to 6.93 divided by the angle 70 degrees. There's our offset by 30 from 40. IBC is 6.93 angle minus 50. And finally, ICA is 6.93 angle 190. And again, those relationships are all offset from their original values because of the 40 degree phase shift in our learning extension here in this case. The delta connected load here in this learning example consists of a 10 ohm resistance in series with a 20 millihenry inductance. The source is Y connected, ABC sequence, and we have 120 volts RMS at 60 hertz. Determine all the line and phase currents. Well, VAN is 120 angle 30 degrees, volts RMS. That's a given. That means that the Z of the inductance, the impedance of the inductance, can be calculated as omega times the value of L, omega L. So 2 pi 60 is omega, times L, which is 20 millihenries, which is 0.020, or if you will, 7.54 as a magnitude. Of course, it's J 7.54 as a complex impedance. And Z delta then would be 10, the series resistance, plus J 7.54, or if you will, 12.52 at an angle of 37.02. We've seen these relationships before for line and phase voltages. V delta is the square root of 3 times V phase. Theta delta is theta phase plus 30 degrees. And that should allow us to do some calculations now. For example, IAB would be VAB divided by Z delta. We already know what Z delta is. VAB is 120 multiplied by the square root of 3 at an angle of 60 degrees, which gives us, and divided by 10 plus J 7.54, which is Z delta, gives us 16.6 angle 22.98 degrees amperes RMS. Likewise, you should try these calculations yourself to see if you can get not only the magnitude, which is always 16.60 if it's a balanced situation, but making sure that you can come up with the correct angles. In this case, minus 97.02 for IBC and angle 142.98 degrees for ICA. And the angles are a little bit more important even than the magnitudes, because in balanced situations, the magnitudes are the same. Magnitude of I line is the square root of 3 times the magnitude of I delta. And theta line is theta delta minus 30 degrees. That's our line phase current relationships. Again, that should be recorded in your notes. It's what we've seen already. Therefore, IAA is 28.75 at an angle of minus 7.02 degrees, if you will. And that, of course, is we got by subtracting 30 degrees from the original IAB, which had an angle of 22.98. Again, the angles are the thing. And of course, the magnitude in this case is the square root of 3 times 16.60. IBB, same magnitude, 28.75, angle minus 127. If you get the first angle correct, the rest fall into place by their vector relationship, of course. And there's always a 120 degree phase angle between them. You have to get the first one right and then the rest fall into place, 120 degrees between them as they go around the phase plot. And ICC, same magnitude, 28.75, angle 112.98 degrees. Alternatively, we can first determine the line currents and then go back calculate what the delta currents are. So the choice is really yours. You should try that as an alternative analysis and see if you can determine the line currents first and then back calculate what the delta current should be. This is section 4, power relationships. So here we have our Y-connected circuit. We can tell that because of the way the loads are set up, and it has the neutral line. And you'll recall when we had first considered power in a single-phase circuit, we developed the idea of complex power. So that was given the symbol S. And in this case, S total, because there are three circuits in our polyphase representation of three-circuit system, it's three times V phase times I phase conjugate. Again, you should review the power relationships in a single phase circuit, which was S is equal to V times I conjugate, if you will. Now we have three of them in the balance situation. Of course, V delta is equal to the square root of 3 V phase. Theta delta equals theta phase plus 30. Again, our line phase voltage relationships, which should definitely be part of your note taking and your analysis. Therefore, S total is the square root of 3 times V line times I conjugate as a result. In the delta situation, which we have here, we get S total is 3 times V line times I delta conjugate. Or if you will, magnitude of I line is equal to the square root of 3 times I delta. And theta line is equal to theta delta minus 30 degrees, the line phase current relationships for the delta configuration. S total then is the square root of 3 times V line times I conjugate of line. When we had considered single phase circuits, we also developed the concept of the power factor and the power factor angle as a result, as the angle between the current and voltage. So we'll define the same power factor angle here also, even though this is a polyphase or three-phase circuit. And again, that's really a function of the impedance, which determines the relationship between the voltage in the line and the current in the line. So P total then would be the square root of 3 times the magnitude of V line times the magnitude of I line times cosine theta F, the power factor. And Q total, which is the complex power, P being the real power. Q total for the complex power would be the square root of 3 magnitude of V line, magnitude of I line, times sine theta of F. And again, you should review your notes for single phase power, and it's exactly the same representation here, except now we're doing it for multiple phase circuits, polyphase circuits. Here's a learning example. We have a delta connected circuit, if you will, with magnitude of V line equals 208 volts RMS. The power, real power total is 1200 watts, that's a given. And it's also given that the power factor angle is 20 degrees lagging. Now we are to determine the magnitude of the line currents and the value of the load impedance per phase in the delta configuration. Again, equally balanced system, but in the delta configuration. Well, P total, as you know from your notes, is an important representation. The square root of 3, magnitude of V line times magnitude of I line, cosine theta F. Q total is the square root of 3 V line, magnitude of I line times sine theta of F. Or if you will, P total divided by 3 would be magnitude of V line divided by magnitude of I line divided by the square root of 3 times cosine theta F, just making a substitution. which implies that in this particular case, since we know what V line is, and we also know what P total is, and of course P total would be for the three phases, that's why we divide it by three. So in this case, we would then be able to calculate that the magnitude of I line would be 3.54 amperes RMS. You may be wondering about this particular algebraic equation. What we've taken is the formula for P total, which was the square root of 3 times the magnitude of V line times the magnitude of I line cosine theta F, and we divided it by 3. So on one side, obviously, we get P total divided by 3, and on the other side, you might wonder, why is there a square root of 3 in the bottom? Well, there was a square root of 3 upstairs in the numerator, and we divide by 3, we would get then the square root of 3 over 3. However, if you normalize and multiply top and bottom by the square root of 3, you get the square root of 3 times the square root of 3, which is 3, and another square root of 3 down in the numerator. And of course, then the denominator has a 3, the numerator has a 3, the 3s cancel. So we essentially end up with 1 over the square root of 3, which is exactly the same representation, except just algebraically rearranged. The magnitude of I line is the square root of 3 times the magnitude of I delta, or theta line is equal to theta delta minus 30 degrees. That's our typical line phase current relationships, delta configuration, which implies that the magnitude of I line in this case would be just 2.05 amperes RMS, starting with the definition for I line that we just calculated, namely 3.54 amperes RMS. And we can also determine what Z delta is, at least the magnitude of Z delta is the magnitude of V line divided by the magnitude of I delta, which means that Z delta, the magnitude, is 101.46 ohms. That's the magnitude of the impedance. And of course, we got that from our power factor angle of 20 degrees, the impedance angle. So we can then formulate from the total power, the impedance power, that Z delta then should be 101.46, the magnitude, which we calculated. And of course, we know the 20 degrees lagging means that it has an angle of 20 degrees for Z delta. So we don't have to calculate it. It's sort of given in the power factor angle specification for the problem. Another learning example, we have an ABC sequence, a balanced YY three-phase circuit. The source has a magnitude of V phase equals 120 volts RMS. Z line is 1 plus J1 ohm. And the impedance of the phase, Z phase, is 20 plus J10. Determine the real and reactive power, of course that means P and Q, per phase at the load, and the total real reactive and complex power being S, at the source. All right, so we can, since this is a balanced situation, we can obviously analyze one circuit at a time. So here we have one circuit. We have 120 angles zero as the given V phase. We have a line of 1 plus J1, and we have a load of 20 plus J10. So in our standard configuration, we then have VAN is 120 angles zero, and of course not shown because they're the other phases. They're 120 degrees apart. We have VBN is minus 120 degrees, same magnitude. And we also have VAN is 120 degrees, plus 120 degrees, magnitudes all being 120. Because the circuit is balanced, any one phase analysis is perfectly sufficient. I sub AA is VAN divided by the total impedance, and the total impedance is 1 plus 20 is 21, and J1 plus J10 is J11. Performing the complex algebraic manipulation, we find that IAA, the current, is 5.06, angle minus 27.65 degrees, amperes RMS. VAN, which is the voltage that appears across the load, is IAA times the load impedance, which is 20 plus J10. Of course, we have to make compensation for the the rectangular representation of the impedance for the load, which we do, and we get that VAN is 113.15 angle minus 1.08 degrees RMS. Now, the phase complex power, S phase, is VAN, the voltage across the load, times IAA, which is the current through it, conjugate. And of course, conjugate can be calculated, since we do know that IAA is 5.06, notice at an angle of minus 27.65. Therefore, I conjugate is 5.06, magnitude doesn't change, but the angle reverses its sign and becomes plus 27.65. We've already calculated VAN, make the substitution, do the calculation, and we find out that S phase is 572.54 angle 26.57, or if you will, 512 plus J 256.09. And the units of complex power are not watts, because that's real power, but volt amperes, RMS. Okay, so unfortunately the graphic is upside down, but even upside down, I can tell you that 512 is the real power, P, and of course, the 256.09 with the J is the complex power, Q. So what about the complex power in the source? Well, that's VAN, because that's the source voltage. Current is still the same, of course, in the Y configuration, balanced Y. So it's IAA conjugate. Again, we have utilized that. We do the calculation, and we find that source phase complex power is 607.2, angle 27.65 degrees, or you can rewrite it, if you will, as 537.86 plus J 281.78. And again, the units are volt amperes, because it's complex power. Looking at the total now, the total source, we can deal with the complex power from the source, and the P total source, the real power from the total source, is just 3 times 537.86, because that was the power in one phase. Likewise, the complex power Q total for the source would be 3 times 2.8178. Notice that the P total source has the units of watts, and the Q total source maintains the units of volt amperes. S total source is P total source plus Q total source. We can add them together. And of course, the magnitude of P total source can be now calculated, and we get 1821.6 volt amperes overall. Another learning example, this time with a delta connected load. The circuit is balanced. Determine the line currents and the combined power factor. Here we have slightly different problems, because here the load impedances do not look to be equal. We have load 1 running at 24 kilowatts at a power factor of 0.6 lagging. We have 10 kilowatts for load 2 at a power factor of 1. And we have 12 kVA at a power factor of 0.8 leading. Now the units are very important, because watts are watts and volt amperes are complex power. So we'll have to take that into consideration as we start our analysis. S is equal to P plus JQ. P is equal to the magnitude of S cosine theta F. Q is equal to the magnitude of S sine theta F. And the power factor, of course, is the cosine of theta F. S total then would be S1 plus S2 plus S3. P1 is given as 24 kilowatts with a 6.6, I should say, lagging, which means that the magnitude of S1 is 40 kilovolt amperes. Again, you should try that calculation, because we're given P, 24 kilowatts, and we're given the power factor, and of course the power factor is the cosine of the angle. So basically we're using P is equal to magnitude of S cosine theta F, and solving for, if you will, magnitude of S, and we'll call it magnitude of S1 because it's the first phase. The magnitude of Q1, and we've seen this before when we did single phase circuits, can be solved if we know what S and P is. The magnitude of Q1 is the square root of the magnitude of S1 squared minus the magnitude of P1 squared. Make the substitution and solve. We get 32 kilovolt amperes for the magnitude of Q1. Since it's lagging as given, it must be inductive and therefore has a positive reactance and also then a positive complex component for Q, because that's what lagging means, inductive. So we get S1 is equal to 24, note the plus sign, J32 kilovolt amperes. And of course, 24 is also kilovolt amperes. For the second load, we do the same calculation, slightly different representation. P2 is 10 kilowatts, but the power factor is 1. And if a power factor is 1, we know that the load is resistive. So notice that there is no complex power, or S2 is merely 10 kilovolt amperes. For load 3, the magnitude of S3 is 12 kVA. That was given. The power factor was 0.8. So now we can back calculate, again, P from the magnitude of S and the cosine of theta F, and then we're given the power factor, so that is the cosine of theta F. So we get P3 is 9.6 kilowatts as a result. And we can also then calculate what Q is, square root of the S squared minus P1 squared, just like we did for the first phase, and we get 7.2 kilovolt amperes. And since it's leading, that means it's capacitive. That means that the complex power has a negative sign. So it's 9.6 minus J7.2 kilovolt amperes. S total is the algebraic sum of S1 plus S2 plus S3. We can add them up. We get 43.6 plus J24.8 kilovolt amperes, or if you will, a magnitude of 50.16 at an angle of 29.63 kilovolt amperes. And in fact, we can take a look at what the power representation would be for complex power, which we have studied before for single phase circuits, inductive being positive Q, as we said, and capacitive having a negative Q or negative complex power. P total is the square root of 3 times V line times I line times cosine theta F, and Q total is the square root of 3 magnitude of V line times magnitude of I line times sine theta of F. The magnitude of S total then is the square root of 3 times V line times I line, and theta F, as far as the total situation is concerned, we've already determined that, and we get 29.63 as the angle. So therefore, the power factor, as far as the total is concerned, is 0.869 lagging as a result, because of a positive sign of the complex power. The magnitude of I line then can be calculated, since we know a variety of different things, including the magnitude of S total. Magnitude of S total was 50.160. We know that magnitude of S total equals the square root of 3 times V line times I line. And we can substitute in what the V line is equal to. It's 208. The magnitude is 208 volts RMS. Notice it's given in the figure in the upper left. And therefore, we can solve for magnitude of I line. And the answer is 139.23 amperes RMS. More to come, because we filled up this particular slide. In this case, if the line impedances are Z line equals 0.5 plus J 0.2 ohms, determine the line voltages and power factors at the source. Well, as we just found, the I line was 139.23 amperes RMS. And S line then would be 3 times Z line times I line times I line conjugate. It's kind of an interesting formula, but basically it's very similar to power is equal to IR squared is what we would do for DC circuits. Remember, we would square the current and multiply by the resistance. The 3 is there because it's 3 phases. But since it's complex, it's 3 times the impedance, Z line, times the magnitude of I line squared. So therefore, S line is 2908 plus J 1163 volt amperes. We're told what Z line is, and we know what I line is, the magnitude anyway. So we perform the numerical calculation, and that's what we get. Notice that I line is, we only need the magnitude of I line, and the complex part comes from the complex impedance for Z line. You should try that calculation to see if you get the same numbers in your analysis. S load total would be 43.6 plus J 24.8 kilovolt amperes, or 50.116 at an angle of 29.63 kilovolt amperes. That's what we got in the last analysis. That's why it's showing up here again under the continuation. S source total then would be, we can take the representation and recast it. S source total then would be 46.508 plus J 25.963. And it has a magnitude of 53.264 at an angle of 29.17 degrees kilovolt amperes. The difference is one is S load total on the load side, and the other S source total on the source side. And again, the inductive and capacitive relationships would tell us a little bit about how the system is looking at the entire network. Positive Q, for example, is inductive. The magnitude of S total, square root of 3 times V line times I line. And we just found that theta F is equal to 29.17 degrees. Therefore, V line can be calculated. Since we know what S total is, magnitude of S total is 53.264 kilovolt amperes divided by the square root of 3 times I line, which we had as 139.23. That should say, it says 13, but it should be 23. And we get about 220.87 volts RMS for V line. The power factor then is cosine theta F. And in this case, from the source point of view, the angle is 29.7, which means the power factor is 0.873 lagging. Of course, we can't tell necessarily from the angle, but we do know that it's a positive complex power, so that tells us the lagging component. This is another learning extension to determine the real reactive and complex power of both load and source. The delta connected source is 208 volts at an angle of 0, minus 120, and minus 240. Of course, that's 208 volts RMS. The line impedances are 0.1 ohms in series with J 0.1. And we have load impedances of 10 in series with J 4. In order to simplify this problem, let's convert the delta connected source to an equivalent Y connected source and then just analyze one phase. So the voltage source becomes 208 divided by the square root of 3. That's the magnitude change. And now at an angle of minus 30 degrees instead of 0 degrees, that's the angle change. And our line becomes 0.1 in series with J 0.2. And of course, then the load has to be changed to the equivalent Y. In this case, it becomes 12 ohms in series with J 4, with the neutral return now actually being a wire, since it is the equivalent Y connection. The complex power S of the load is 3 times VAN, as indicated in the figure, times IAA conjugate, which is equivalent to writing 3 times the magnitude of VAN squared divided by the conjugate of the phase impedance, Z conjugate. So substitution, in looking at it another way, we can also write it as 3 times the magnitude of VAN squared divided by Z conjugate total phase, essentially, which is what we're going to be using here. Or VAN turns out to be 12 plus J4 divided by 12 J0.1 plus J4.2, and of course that's really the addition of the two impedances, the line impedances, which is 0.1 plus J0.2, and the load impedance, which is 12 plus J4, and that of course sums up to 12.1 plus J4.2. And our voltage in this case has already been calculated as 120 angle minus 30 degrees. VAN then is 118.65 volts RMS. We can also consider the complex power of the load. Substitution of the voltage that we just found. Now we can put that in there. 3 times the magnitude of 118.65 squared divided by J minus 4. We multiply top and bottom by the complex conjugate of J minus 4, which is actually J plus 4. So you'll notice that the denominator becomes 12 squared plus 4 squared, or if you will, A squared plus B squared. And in the numerator, we have an additional term, 12 plus J4. We can then continue the calculation in another way, as 3 times the magnitude of 120 squared divided by the same impedance ratio, 12.1 plus J4.2. But in this case, we're using Z total phase. So we're using 12.1 plus J4.2 divided by Z total, the complex conjugate of Z total phase, which makes it a real number downstairs. Notice it's 12.1 squared plus 4.2 squared. Compare the two equations, and you'll see that they're similar but not matching. And they differ, of course, in the impedances, the impedance divider, and also the voltages. So the complex power in the load is given by this equation, and the complex power in the source is given by this equation by calculating the two equations that we have right above. And therefore, we then have the real reactive power of both the load and the source by definition. Another learning extension, a 480-volt RMS line feeds two balanced three-phase loads. The loads are rated, one load is rated at 5 kilovolt amperes at 0.8 power factor lagging, and the other one is 10 kilovolt amperes at 0.9 power factor lagging. And our quest is to determine the magnitude of the line current from the 408-volt RMS source. We do have some defining equations. Complex power S is equal to P plus JQ. P then is the magnitude of S times cosine theta of the power factor angle. Q is the magnitude of S times the sine of the power factor angle. And the power factor angle is related to the power factor, as P sub F, the power factor, is equal to the cosine of the power factor angle theta F. And also, the complex power total is S1 plus S2 because we have two loads in this case. So the magnitude of S1 is 5 kVA. So that's P divided by 0.8 by definition, which means that P is equal to 4 kilowatts. Q then is the magnitude of S1 squared minus P1 squared. So that's 3 kilovolt amperes. The power factor lagging means that S1 is 4 plus J, 3 kilovolt amperes, if you will. So 4 kilowatts, not written as kilowatts, but it is 4 kilowatts plus 3 J kilovolt amperes, complex power overall. S2 can be calculated also, same formulas, 10 kVA equals the power P divided by 0.9. So that means P is 9 kilowatts, since it's real power. Q2, by the same formula, magnitude of S2 squared minus P2 squared, 4.36 kilovolt amperes as a result. And S2 is 9 kilowatts, but we can write it as complex power, as 9 plus J, 4.36 kVA, kilovolt amperes. S total then, we did say S total was the sum of S1 plus S2. Real parts add, complex parts add, and we get 13 plus J, 7.36, and the overall units are kilovolt amperes. So essentially each one is multiplied by 1,000. We also know that P total is the square root of 3 times V line times I line times cosine theta F. Q total is the square root of 3 times V line I line sine theta F. And likewise, the magnitude of S total is the square root of 3 the magnitude of V, the magnitude of I, of the line. So the magnitude of the line, if you will, is the magnitude of S total divided by the square root of 3 times the voltage of the line. Substituting the numbers that we got, you should perform the calculation to verify the calculation. We end up with 17.97 amperes RMS as the total current that's being supplied, I should say, because we're dealing with the total power and the voltage on the line. Okay, another learning example, which asks the following question. For this circuit, which circuit is the source and what is the average power supply? So we have system X and system Y. You can consider them as a motor generator set where you have either a generator or a motor, and we're not sure whether system X is the motor or the generator, and likewise whether system Y is the generator or the motor. But we do know some things. We know that VAB is 12 angle 0 kilovolts RMS. We also know that VAB capital, VAB on the other side, on the right-hand side, is 12 angle 5 degrees kilovolts RMS. And we know the lines are balanced, 1 ohm plus J2, and it is neutral return, so we would speculate that this is a Y-connected circuit. Determine the current flowing. Convert line voltages to phase voltages at that point. Well, we have for each phase, equivalent for the first phase, we have 12 divided by the square root of 3. That's how we would figure out the phase representation, because remember we had VAB, now we want VAN. So it's 12 divided by the square root of 3, angle minus 30 kilovolts RMS. And at the opposite, on the right-hand side, V sub capital AN is 12 to the square root of 3 minus 25 degrees, because we started out initially with a plus 5 degree angle. So plus 5 minus 30 is minus 25 degrees kilovolts RMS. Therefore, VAA is VAN minus VAN. Well, you can read the notation, little AN and capital AN, divided by 1 plus J2, the line impedance. Substitution of those numbers, we have mixed mode calculation, the difference of polar forms upstairs, which is not good, divided by a rectangular form in the numerator, which is not good, so we have to straighten that out. We'll leave that for you to do to verify your calculator. Always effectively a test that you should make to make sure that you understand how to manipulate complex numbers. And the answer is 207.3 at an angle of minus 180.93 amperes RMS. That's what I sub A capital A would be. SY is 3 times VAN, capital AN, times IAA conjugate, and SX would be 3 VAN minus AA, I conjugate. SY then would be the square root of 3 times 12 times 0.2703 angle minus 25 plus 180.93, and we'll write that as millivolts amperes. And SX can be likewise calculated a similar form. We have minus the square root of 3, though, times 12 times 0.2703. And, of course, it's written that way because we've made the calculation in millivolt amperes. Not millivolt, millions of volt amperes. At an angle of minus 30 plus 180.93 degrees, if you will. The angles come from the calculation, of course, and so do the magnitudes. S is equal to P plus JQ. P is equal to the magnitude of S cosine of the phase angle of the power factor angle. We'll call that theta F. And therefore, PY is minus 5.13 megawatts. And P sub X is 4.91 megawatts. Capital M obviously stands for million. Little m would stand for milli, but we don't have thousands here. We have millions. System Y, then, by definition, is the source because P sub X is consuming power, and therefore P sub Y has a negative effective power because that's because system Y is, in fact, the source. The losses can be calculated as the difference between PX and PY, if you will. And phase differences essentially determine the direction of power flow. Or, if you will, the real part of the power also does the same thing as we saw. This is section 5, power factor correction. Similar to single phase case that we have studied before, we're going to use capacitors to increase the power factor. The desirable factor, power factor, of course, is 1, which means that current and voltage would be in phase. So we have to, though, keep clear about what we mean by total phase power, line voltages, line phase voltages, and the power factor correction as a result. So S old and power factor old implies Q old, complex power old, and P old, power factor new, is going to be then used to can infer what complex power new is, Q new. The change in Q, the complex or reactive power, is Q new minus Q old. How much reactive power has to be added, for example? To use capacitors, this value should be negative. The voltage depends on how the capacitors are connected, because Q per capacitor is minus omega, we need to know the radiant frequency, times the capacitor value C, times the V squared. This is very similar to the single phase calculation, now just being extended to three phase. S is equal to P plus JQ. P is equal to the magnitude of S cosine of the phase of the power factor angle theta F. Q is the magnitude of S, the sine of the power factor angle theta F. And the power factor as a number is equal to the cosine of the power factor angle theta F. That also implies that Q is equal P, putting the two equations together, those two equations for P and Q. Notice the magnitude of S cancels, and we get Q is equal to P, the tangent of the power factor angle theta F. And if it's lagging, that means Q is greater than zero. The power factor is equal to cosine theta F is equal to sine theta F, can be applied from, I should say, can be implied from, not equal to, but can be applied from sine theta f, as sine theta f is equal to the square root of 1 minus the power factor squared, and the tangent of theta f is equal to the power factor divided by the square root of 1 minus the power factor squared. These are just trigonometric identities, relying on their definitions in terms of cosine and sine. For example, if the power factor is cosine theta f, then sine theta f is 1, is the square root of 1 minus cosine squared, which is why we get the square root of 1 minus the power factor squared. And likewise for the tangent calculation. So let's do a learning example to put this into practice. Here we have f equals 60 hertz, because we need to know what omega is. We have the magnitude of V line is 34.5 kilovolts RMS. And we require a power factor to be 0.94 leading, is what we require. The balance load is 24 MVA, million volt amperes, at a 0.78 power factor lagging. Notice it's lagging, and we want 0.94 leading. And 0.78 is kind of a pitiful power factor, and then, of course, it's compounded by being highly inductive with lagging. So S is equal to P plus JQ, P is equal to mag S cosine theta F, Q is equal to mag S sine theta F. We know we put those together, we get Q equals P tan F, if you will. Or if you will, tan F is equal to power factor divided by the square root of 1 minus power factor squared. And since we desire, when it starts out being lagging, that means that Q old is in fact greater than zero. It's an important concept. Power factor is equal to cosine theta F equals sine theta F. We put in our value for the power factor that we started out with, square it, take the square root, we get 0.626. That means when we start out, we have Q old, magnitude of Q old as a result from the equations, since we now know what the power factor is. We end up with magnitude of Q old is 15.02 MVA. And P old is equal to 18.72 megawatts. So P old is 18.72 megawatts. However, we want a new power factor to be 0.94 leading. That means that we need, in order to balance that, we need Q nu to be minus 6.8 MVA. Because we substitute in the PF nu is 0.94, we calculate the angle, and we do know what P old is. So that's how we end up calculating Q nu in terms of Q is equal to P tan F. Please try that calculation yourself. The change in Q complex or reactive power is minus 6.8 minus 15.02. In other words, we determined that we need minus 6.8 MVA in the new setting, desired setting, but we did have 15.02 in the old setting, and that was in fact lagging, so that's why it's negative. So it's minus 6.8 minus 15.02. With the differences, remember the differences are, you subtract the Q's. So 15.02 is a positive number because it's lagging, but when you subtract it, it becomes a negative number. So you get minus 6.8 minus 15.02 minus 21.82 MVA overall. And the overall result then means that the capacitors that we need to store, that's what the delta Q is. Here's the input that we get because it's a three-phase system. With a three-phase system, we have three capacitors. So minus 21.82 is then distributed across three equal capacitors, and each one will then be minus 7.273, or 21.82 divided by 3. It's for the Y-connected case, the voltage across the capacitor would be 34.5, the square root of 3 kilovolts RMS. And we can substitute in the value of the Q of the capacitor, minus 7.23 times 10 to the 6th. That, of course, is megavolt amperes, 10 to the 6th, is equal to minus omega 2 pi 60 times C, which we don't know, times the voltage squared. 34.5 times 10 to the 3rd is kilovolts divided by the square root of 3, quantity squared. Substitution algebraically and getting the correct calculation, and please do this calculation because the answer is shown in microfarads, or if you will, 48.6 times 10 to the minus 6 farads, or 4.86 times 10 to the minus 5 farads. So when you have scientific notation, we can also render it in terms of regular electrical units, in this case, microfarads. Another example, we have the same situation, 60 hertz frequency, V line is 34.5 kilovolt RMS. We require the power factor to be 0.9 volts lagging. We have a balanced load of 24 MVA, 0.7 power factor lagging in our system. We have the same set of equations as we've had before. Can calculate the same value of the power factor. Calculate the old and the new P. In this case, we get power factor lagging 0.9. So the Q nu in this case is minus 9.067 megavolt amperes. The change in Q, this is a different problem, as you can tell. You can go back and look at the previous learning example. But this case, delta Q is 9.067 minus 15.02. And that, of course, is because the power factor is lagging. So we end up with the difference in this case, which is minus 5.953 MVA. And in this case, the Q per capacitor is minus 9.84. In other words, taking that value, minus 5.953, and dividing it across three equal capacitors. Y connected, as before, same calculation as before, the unknown value of C. Of course, what's different is the Q per capacitor. Go back and review and compare and contrast these two calculations. And you find in this case that C is equal to 13.26 microfarads. Another learn by design. We have, just as for professional interest, we have number 4 wire. which is rated at 170 amperes RMS. And we have a balanced three-phase source running at 13.8 kilovolts, and we're asked to find whether this particular wire can handle the currents required by three parallel connected loads, three different stores running off the same three-phase high-voltage source. Store 1 has 700 kVA with 0.8 power factor 0.8 lagging. Store number 2 is 1,000 kVA with 0.5 lagging. And store number 3, 800 kVA with 0.9 lagging. Now, since they are in parallel, we can just calculate them in parallel and add up the results to see if it meets our target for our requirement for the wire which is feeding these loads. So, number 1, is the wire suitable? What capacitor then would be required to have a composite, which means overall for all three stores, a power factor of 0.92 lagging, and the capacitors are to be Y connected. Okay. In this case, we have a three load system. So S total is S1 plus S2 plus S3. And of course, by now we know that S is equal to P plus JQ. P is equal to the magnitude of S cosine theta F, power factor angle. Q is equal to magnitude of theta S sine theta F. And of course, the power factor is the cosine of the power factor angle. In the Y connection, we have S total is equal to 3 times V phase times I phase conjugate, or if you will, the square root of 3 times V line times I line conjugate. Well, S1 we can calculate as we're given that it's 700 kVA, we'll just leave it as kVA for now. And our 0.8 power factor lagging means that an angle is 36.9 degrees, which we can then render as a rectangular representation for S1. Try 560 plus J420. Each of those are multiplied, of course, by K or 1,000, and the overall is kVA. So it's 560,000 plus J420,000 volt amperes. Similar calculation for 2. Store number 2, 1,000 at an angle of 60, power factor was 0.5, 500 plus J866 kVA. Store number 3, 800, in this case at an angle of 25.8 degrees, 720 plus J349 kVA. So we can do the total, since they're the sum of the three loads that are parallel. In rectangular form, which we can add together, we add the three real parts, we get 1780. We add the three complex parts, we get J1635, and the units are kVA. We can render that then in polar form, phasor form, as 2417 angle 42.57 kVA. And then the definition of I line is gotten. I line is the magnitude of S total, remember we're dealing with the line here, divided by the square root of 3 times V line. V line is given as 13.8 kilovolts, or 13.8 times 10 to the third. The magnitude of S total we calculated, remember it was 2417 kVA, I can render that in scientific notation as 2.417 times 10 to the sixth. We got 10 to the third from the K, and we moved over 2417 to become 2.417. We picked up another 10 to the third, that's how we got 10 to the sixth. Do the mathematical calculation, and we get 101.1 amperes RMS for the line. So, if it's 101.1 amperes RMS, the line is rated at 170. Seems to be quite a significant safety factor. The line at that particular rating should be fine. Okay, continuing on with the problem though, P old and the power factor new provides Q new. And of course, that's P tangent theta F nu, or if you will, 758.28 kVA as a result. The change in Q, complex or reactive power, is Q nu minus Q old, which is minus 876.72 kVA. Those particular numbers come from what we just calculated. So it would be instructive for you to determine what, say, P old is, and theta F is, and then make sure that the calculations are agreeing with what you see. The magnitude of Q per capacitor then in the Y-connected system would be omega CV squared. And V is equal to the magnitude of V phase, which in this case is 13.8 kV divided by the square root of 3. Solving for the only unknown C, I'm going to assume that this is 60 hertz, although the problem doesn't state it, but we will assume it is. Solving for the value of C from what we have, and we get a value of 12.2 microfarads per capacitor, essentially, across the Y-connected system. So let's look at the incremental cost of the power factor. This is actually taking our engineering calculations for power factor and load and that sort of thing, and working it in terms of a financial representation. How much capacitance is required to improve the factor by a fixed amount? So for example, 0.01. So PF minus P new minus PF old is equal to 0.01. While PF old is cosine theta old, tan theta old is Q old divided by P. PF new is cosine theta new, tan theta new is Q old minus QC, the capacitors that we add divided by P. And of course, QC is supplied by the capacitors that are part of the system. So taking ratios and solving, we get QC over P is equal to Q old over P minus tangent theta new. And tangent theta nu, in fact, is tangent theta old minus tangent theta nu, essentially, because we can substitute for Q old over P, if you will, because Q over P, as you see in the very top of center of the screen, is tan theta old. So that's now we can write QC over P as the difference of tan theta old minus tan theta nu. And of course, we can then do some trigonometric identities as far as the calculations are concerned. The theta old is actually the arc cosine. He writes it as a cos. The arc cosine of PF old, and tan theta and theta nu is the arc cosine, or if you will, a cosine of P power factor old, but now by the incrementation, which is 0.01. Well, we can look at a graphical relationship, which is a little bit beyond just a numerical calculation. Required reactive power per watt, QC over P, divided by the original power factor PF old. So it gives us a representation of what we need to do to move in any particular direction, starting with the PF old and then changing it by no more than 0.1. You could see that there's an extreme at the right-hand side because the incremental change requires more and more capacitive storage. So the minimum part, which is a way that we can look at this information, the minimum part is the least expensive because you can move 0.01 very easily with hardly changing the capacitance at all. And the minimum occurs somewhere around 0.8 power factor. It becomes very expensive, as we said, as the power factor approaches 1. That's why we get that asymptotic rise at the end. That's an interesting way of presenting information, and often electrical engineers are required not only to do calculations, but also to make judgments about financial concerns. Capacitor specifications. Capacitors for power factor correction are normally specified in VARs, volt ohms reactive. The magnitude of the complex reactive power per capacitor, Q per capacitor, is equal to omega CV squared. The voltage and frequency must be given in order to know the capacitance. We usually assume, as we did in one problem, that it's 60 hertz unless any other value is given, but it would be nice if you had a certainty of what the radian frequency would be, omega, or the frequency F. So for a power factor of 0.94 leading, one needs a capacitor, as we found, of 48.6 microfarads for this particular problem. Remember the balanced three-phase source, and then a 24 MVA at a 0.78 power factor lagging required quite a lot of capacitance to change it from lagging to leading. And we have values that we can use. We can use different rated capacitances. and their rated storage as a result. The choices that are available, they say, is 10, 50, and 20 kilovolts with different values of their rated Q, which means that we're telling you what the capacitance would be at the different rated voltages, and the capacitance is built in and it's produced, it produces a number as Q. Remember, Q is equal to omega CV squared. So if the rated voltage is V, we don't even know what the capacitor voltage is, but we do know that omega is 2 pi 60. And these are three different cases where we have the voltages V being either 10, 50, or 20. So V line in this particular case was 34.5 kilovolts, and that means the phase voltage is in the Y-connected situation. We can see the neutral return would be 19.9 kilovolts. Capacitor 1, though, is not rated high enough because it's only rated at 10 kilovolts. Sorry, you lose. And C1, if it was available, would be 4 times 10 to the 6th mega volt ohms reactive divided by omega CV squared. Omega is 2 pi 60, and then V squared is 10,000 squared. So if it would be available, it's 106.1, but it doesn't meet the voltage requirements. C2 is certainly meets the voltage requirements, and we can do its calculation, and we find out that it's 26.53 microfarads. And C3 is also just barely available. Remember that the phase voltage is 19.9 kilovolts, and capacitor 3 is rated at 20 kilovolts, not much of a safety margin. But notice the capacitance is much larger also. It's 49.7 microfarads. Capacitor 3 is the best alternative because it certainly has the energy storage capabilities, but I would offer too that its rated voltage is too close to the phase voltage and there's not much of a safety margin. So this is really a judgment call on your part, since you can't out of hand reduce capacitor 3, case 3, as a non-operable case like we could with case 1. With that, we're at the end of sections 3 to 5 of chapter 11.